pour les fidèles du forum, ils connaissent déjà Itay Talgam, le père, qui nous avait fait une démonstration assez fascinante et dont les gens me parlent encore aujourd'hui, plusieurs années après. Et là, il y a Itay et son fils Imri qui vont vous parler à leur manière de musique.
Hello. Hello, everybody. Good to know that you're alive and you can speak and you're smiling. And can we have more light over there? Because it looks like a KGB interrogation room or something. Okay, Imri, this is my son, Imri.
Hi, everyone.
Hello. We enjoy a kind of a father-son relationship. But you can have a seat because you're going to play in a second. I'm here to actually make a tribute to French culture. Actually, not just to French culture, but for at least 200 years of French ignorance. You don't look amused. You're not amused. I'll just, can we have the slide that I was making? I wrote this book. You'll see it in a minute, I hope. It is called The Ignorant... Oh, there it is. You see? That's actually the same book, only the American edition and the English edition. You can, of course, guess which is the American. That's the one that looks like a Hollywood movie of after the nuclear mushroom something. Anyhow, this is a homage to Jacques Rancière. Who wrote The Ignorant Schoolmaster. And in his turn, he made a homage to another French intellectual, Jacques Cousteau, from the 19th century. That's why I said 200 years of French ignorance, who said this wonderful thing, among other things. He said that education should be done by ignorant people. You know why? Because an ignorant can teach another ignorant what he himself does not know. Shall I repeat? An ignorant can teach another ignorant what he himself does not know. This is fantastic. Look around you. How many ignorants you see in the room? True? Now, come on. I don't mean to insult you. I know that you know millions of things, but for every one thing that you know, there are a million others that you don't know. Now, how come only an ignorant can teach? Why is it good to be ignorant? Why should I pay homage to that and even put it as the title of my book? Because if you know everything, then people you teach or people you lead can only get to the height of your authority. You understand? On the other hand, if you know that you don't know, but you are still an expert in teaching, you will be able to build a platform which will help your students, or if you lead other people as a politician, as a businessman, your platform will help them discover things that you yourself could not imagine. Now, why is that important, and why we have this wonderful pianist sitting here? Is it because culture has to be inclusive. And the idea of shared ignorance as a basis for culture is a great inclusive principle. You have to add to it another one by Jacques Cousteau. Jacques Cousteau said that all intelligences are equal. That means if you're an expert carpenter, you're as good as an expert banker or lawyer or whatever. You understand? Okay. So, even more than in any just culture, contemporary culture, which is really, really challenging in terms of getting people to connect, will benefit a lot from ignorance. So let me ask you, when you go, now all assume ignorance, please. You're all ignorant now and you come into a concert hall. What would be the first thing to connect you and a performing artist? Can you play something? Just.
Thank you.
I'll interrupt him, because this is not, it's not about Chopin. It's about what connects you to the playing artists. First of all, is virtuosity. It's like going to a circus, right? You're standing there, sitting there, watching this crazy guy going on high wire, and you say, it's really dangerous. The guy knows something. Yeah? And you understand immediately that he knows that because he dedicated himself. And you connect. You remember your own stories of dedication and failures. And so this is one thing. But, you know, it could also be just, you know, cheap token of play something cheap, like, you know, virtuosic, but stupid. Okay, it's not stupid, but you can understand. It could be quite mechanical, and still people will admire it. But there are other maybe I'll give it to you. There are other sorts of virtuosity.
Yes, and maybe those are kinds of virtuosity that have to do not with a direct physicality of what you see in the playing, not the acrobatics, but the kind of mental acrobatics that goes on while someone is playing. So how about this little example, which I'm sure you'll recognize. This is virtuosity that comes from polyphonic music, from playing music which has many voices at the same time. So I suppose most of you probably have heard that. It's one of the canons from the Goldberg Variations. And the kind of virtuosity that is required here is a virtuosity of, while being one performer, essentially being three different people, like three different voices who sing together, and who each have a completely individual melodic line, which has to come out independently. Let me play this one through. So obviously, there is something completely different going on in terms of virtuosity. The virtuosity is also in the fingers, but it is first and foremost in the mind. It's a virtuosity of creating music which has so many different layers at the same time. And maybe this can be a good connection to the big piece that I want to show you today, piano piece by Karlheinz Stockhausen from 1956, which I think involves a completely different, again, kind of virtuosity of playing the instrument in new ways and in completely unexpected ones. The first of these very unexpected things is what I'm pulling out of my pocket is a couple of gloves. And you'll see in a moment why I need them. The simple answer might be that I'm going to play with my fingers in the normal way, but I'm also going to be playing the piano in different ways, using the whole of my hand as well as my arms, as you'll see. And these gloves are meant to reduce friction. So some actual acrobatics here. And now, I think the reason that this piece is interesting from the perspective of ignorance is that, as you'll see, it involves two completely different ways of experiencing time in music. One is a very condensed, very intense sort, where you have really too many things going on to fully understand what is happening and follow. And the other is moments where nothing happens except a decay of a single sound. And I think that requires you each time to listen differently, and it becomes something that teaches you that you have to be open in this way towards listening. I'll play a little bit an example of each one of these kinds of moments. And then you could have something like this as well. And so on. It's even longer. So as you see, completely different kinds of listening and completely different kinds of ignorance.
Can I interrupt for a second?
Please.
How many of you found it difficult to listen to? And why is the difficulty? Because of expectations. You all know, for example, in your marriage, that lowering expectation is the key to happiness. So all you have to do is take it to the extreme when you come here. Now, this is very, very, very difficult to do, I think. But I would like to say this piece is, what, 24 minutes long?
Something like that.
Yeah, something
24 minutes long. And every note is exactly written in terms of everything in the score. How can one remember so many different notes? I did ask Imri, is that the official delegation of whom, actually? Some official delegation. Anyhow, how do you remember all that? And Imri said, tell me, how do you remember all those notes? How can you play that without a score?
Well, I think whatever piece of information you are learning, there's a natural tendency to group them into events, bigger chunks of information. So in the same way, for example, that you don't remember a telephone number by remembering every single digit, but you remember groups of 3 and 4 digits, right? It's different in every country, but the principle is the same. Then it's much easier. The same thing happens with this piece. You don't remember every note, you remember groups. And then part of the process of learning such a piece is to first make groups and learn them, and then make completely different groups. So in the telephone number analogy, you're learning different divisions of those numbers.
Mm. So in a crude way, Imri was speaking about taking something that happens in music and actually copying the same set of mental principles to the real world. Well, of course, there are more important things to remember than telephone numbers, but the idea of taking some kind of reality and then restructuring it, thinking of it in different structure, is one that, you know, once you do that, you don't know it in advance, but we start listening and you start doing it, and then you do it again differently, it teaches you something about your life, hopefully, which I don't know. Can we maybe go to Nenko?
Yes, absolutely.
So there's another. What's the exact name?
Konon Nenkro.
Nenkro. Anybody heard about Nenkro? Are you ignorant? Are you proud ignorance? Thank you. So I didn't know about this guy either, but he was a very special character, and the reason I asked him to speak about him is, and he will do in a moment, is the fact that this guy examined the relations between human and machine in a fantastic way, again, that lets us take something from music and copy it back into the world. Now, of course, man-machine, anybody here who saw Charlie Chaplin's Modern Times, you know that you can, you know, say something about it in a very artistic way, but then usually it says something like, you know, a parody, and you know it's a problem, but you're not getting any nearer to solving the problem of this robot making him eat whatever. But Nenkro does come up with something interesting. Please tell us something about this guy, and then play.
Well, there are a couple of reasons that Nenkro is not well known. The first is biographical. He was an American composer, but he actually lived his whole life in Mexico, since as a communist, you know, living in the States was quite difficult back in the 50s. And the second reason I think is even more interesting, and that is that the majority of the music that he wrote was actually written not for live players, not for performers, but rather for machines, for mechanical pianos, pianolas. If you remember those instruments that you know, existed in the world for entertainment purposes back then, 20s and 30s. So essentially he was writing computer music before computers were available. So I want to conclude by just playing this piece written for a mechanical piano, which I've transcribed and made into a version for a human player. It's a very, very short canon. If you can hear that, it lasts 1 minute. Thanks.
Merci. Merci.
Happy ignorance to everybody. Happy ignorance.
Merci, Tay. Merci, Emery. Thank you so much for being here today.
Anytime.
Thank you. Yes, bye-bye. Next time in Avignon.